It's May 2nd, 2021. Welcome to online worship at the Rockaway Cathedral. We are so glad that you have chosen to be with us this morning. Whether you're just having a look or seeking a place to worship, we are delighted to have you here. And though we may not be able to meet together physically, that is not going to stop us from rallying together spiritually. Join us online for a time of worship and a message from Pastor Marlon Curtin.
Join us in experiencing the joy of singing to the Lord with the gospel duo, Melody and Harmony.
Take my gift off the shelf, I'll pray, yeah.
The Word of God changes lives. Join us as we dedicate time to study the Word of God at Bible study on Wednesdays from 7 to 8 p.m. Meet us on Zoom at meeting ID 960-2462-6792 and the password 271927. Visit the Rockaway Cathedral website for the Zoom link. Come prepared with your digital or printed copy of the book Grace and Free Will by St. Augustine. It's available for purchase on Amazon, eBay, at Barnes & Noble, and Walmart. COVID-19 is still with us. We are seeing an increase in the availability and the administering of vaccines. Even the eligibility for vaccines has been increased to include individuals age 16 and above. However, we are still seeing increased positive cases, especially in young people. The variant virus accounts for the majority of these new cases. New York and New Jersey are experiencing some of the highest rates of infection in the nation. Just as businesses are being allowed to open according to protocols and public schools are about to reopen, medical officials say that we must follow the safe six: hand washing, wearing double masks, social distancing, staying home while you are and if you're beginning to feel sick, getting tested regularly, and getting the vaccine as soon as you are eligible. That's it. Let's do our part to beat this virus. We're doing it for each other. God bless you, and remember, stay safe. Save the date on Saturday, July 31st. We're gearing up for our first live event in Far Rockaway, and you're invited. So just add July 31st to your calendar. We hope to see you there.
Let's pray. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Lord, we pray for souls. Bring in souls from the east, bring in souls from the west, bring in souls from the south, bring in souls from the north. Bring in souls from Queens, bring in souls from Brooklyn, bring in souls from the Bronx, from Manhattan, from Staten Island, from Nassau County, from Suffolk County, from New Jersey, from Connecticut. Bring in souls, Lord. Lord, let this be a harvest of souls. Bring in people who are black, bring in people who are white, bring in men, bring in women, bring in young people, bring in senior citizens, bring in people who have multiple degrees, bring in people with no degrees, bring in people with money, bring in people without money, bring in people who have very few problems, bring in people who have multitudes of problems. Lord, I call in souls right now in the name of Lord Jesus. Bring in souls from the north. Bring in souls from the south, bring in souls from the east, bring in souls from the west. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that this is a harvest time, not only for this church, but for the body of Christ at large. Lord, the pandemic is on its way out. Society is about to reopen. Let people not forget all the hardships they went through, and let them turn their hearts and their minds and their thoughts to God. Give us the boldness, give us the strength that we need, give us the anointing that we need to reach those that are lost, even as the economy opens up and even as society opens up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture of the day is taken from Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 to 31 in the King James Version. Who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that she shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant's ship. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considereth a field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth the vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretches out her hand to the poor, yet she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates.
Welcome, good morning. Welcome to the Rockaway Cathedral. It's giving time. It's offering time. Many years ago, the Lord called me to preach. It was January 1st, 1986. Didn't actually start pastoring until September 27th, 2020. What happened in between? Well, the Lord was taking me through a journey. There's some things that, I went to Penn State University, great school, but, you know, there's a big party scene there. So that had to bring me out of that. You know, started working as an attorney, and, you know, there's some, you know, on the social side, there's some things that are going on. Had to bring me through that. It seemed like a long time to me. It took a while for me to get from January 1st, 1986 to September 27th, 2020. But, you know, the truth is, I mean, you don't need a hip-hop pastor who's, you know, kind of still going to clubs and parties. You don't need a bump and grind pastor who's picking up women on the side when we go to these clubs and parties or happy hours and things like that. The Lord had to bring me through all of those things. I'm not saying I'm a perfect person. I'm not, you know, certainly not there. I'll be there when I get to heaven. We'll all be perfect. But there's some things in my life that the Lord had to work through, had to go through. I'm writing a book about that. So hopefully it'll be coming to you soon. But, you know, you can't have a hip-hop pastor. You can't have a pastor who's trying to do things improperly while their pastor can't pick up women. I will tell you that I will not be trying to pick up your wife. I will not be trying to pick up your daughter. I will not be taking your money, using it on personal business. That's just not going to happen. We ask for your offerings for one particular reason. It's our goal, it's our vision, the vision that the Lord has given me to minister in Far Rockaway, Queens. We need the resources, the finances to get us from where we are to where we need to be. So, you know, the goal is to have an opening in September. We're on track for that. But in order to do that, we need to start doing a number of events in Far Rockaway starting in July. So starting in July and going into August, we've already been in contact with some people with a group that could give us, we think, what we need in order to start ministering in Far Rockaway ahead of our opening in September. All these things cost money. We're going to need volunteers. We're going to need resources. So I'm asking you, those that are members of the Rockaway Cathedral. In other words, if I am your pastor right now, I need you to tithe. I need you to give us a tenth of your income according to the Word of God. For those of us where I am your pastor, but you're not ready to tithe, we need you to give a regular offering. You know, some people who are doing well could give between $100 and $200 a month. Those that are, you know, maybe not so can give hopefully $50 a month. If I am your pastor, you're not ready to tithe, but you're ready to give an offering, that's what we want you to do. And for those who want to be partners, you already have a pastor, you already have a ministry, you're already committed to the Word, to the faith community where you are, but you believe in and you want to support our vision for the Rockaway Cathedral, we're asking you, again, if you're doing pretty well financially, to give $50 a month. If things are a little bit tight, we ask you to give at least $20 a month. So there's room for all of you. If you're a member, I want you to tithe. If you're a member, but you're not ready to tithe, please give regularly. If you're a partner because you're part of a faith community somewhere else, we ask you to partner with us. Thank God. We had a brother pledge $2,000 and also agree to pay $600 a month. That's paid and being paid. We had another sister who pledged $1,000 and is pledging $400 a month. That's paid and ongoing. We had another brother pledge $300, paid. Another brother pledged $300, paid. Another brother pledged $150, halfway paid, will be paid in full shortly. And we've had unexpected gifts. A family unexpectedly gave us $500 for some things that we were involved with, involving their family. Another family unexpectedly gave us $310. People are starting to give. People are committed to this ministry. People are committed to us going forward. We need your help. Now, I'm just going to say it, it'll be flat out. This message, this appeal will be done between now and August because we really need $10,000. Of course, we need regular money, regular giving, but we need a one-time gift from anyone. You know, if one person has it, send us an email and then go online and give or mail a check to our business address and give. If four of you want to get together and give $2,500 a piece, send us an email saying you want that, want to do that. Because we have some expenses we need to pay, and we have some money that we need to basically plant as a seed in order for us to minister in July and August. We need a bus to carry people down there. We need volunteers. We need people to do things on the ground for an extended period of time in July and August leading up to our opening in September. So this appeal will be made every week until now. And then, of course, if we get the $10,000 pledge, we'll modify this appeal. But we need your support. Thank you so far for those that have given, for those that are regular listeners. We urge you to fit into one of those four categories. And for that one or for that group, God bless you. We believe that you will give that $10,000 that we need. So God bless you. And enjoy the rest of the broadcast.
The Rockaway Cathedral is a nonprofit organization that is seeking to win souls for the Lord in the Far Rockaway community. We especially want to make a difference in the lives of those who have been disenfranchised by poverty, poor health outcomes, poor education, and high incarceration rate. We plan to put boots on the ground in Far Rockaway by July 2021 if COVID permits, and to have a physical presence by September. However, we need your support to get there. Your act of kindness can be a lifesaver for someone. Remember, richness is not necessary, but willingness is. Please visit our website, www.therockawaycathedral.com. Click on the blue Donate tab on the bottom of the page, and then click Make a Donation. We are also asking you to continue to support us by viewing our service once a week and calling into our weekly prayer line. We thank you for both your partnership and continued support. We're now on Cash App. You can send your donations to hashtag Rockaway Cathedral. We thank you for your partnership and continued support.
Good morning. Good morning. God bless you. This is Pastor Marlon Curtin. There's a song that goes, I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. I get peace when I think about what he's done for me. You don't know like I know what he's done for me. You don't know like I know what he's done for me. It's a great song. So today is part one of a three-part series called What He's Done For Me. It's about what God has done for us. You know, everybody likes to talk about what we're supposed to do and all this other stuff. But today of this series, we'll focus on the things that God has done for us in the body of Christ. So be blessed. Today is part one, righteousness, what he's done for me. God bless you.
Before we get into the Word, let's get ready once again for another selection from the gospel duo, Melody and Harmony.
God bless you. Today's message is called What He's Done For Me. What He's Done For Me, Part 1, Righteousness. What He's Done For Me, Part 1, Righteousness. Today's scripture can be found in Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Romans chapter 14, verse 17. I'm going to be reading from the King James Bible. Please stand for the reading of God's Word. Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Here beginneth the reading of God's word. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So far the scripture. Lord, speak to your people today. Speak through your servant. In Jesus' name, amen. So, obviously the Greek, the Old Testament is written in Hebrew, New Testament is written in Greek. The Greek word for righteousness means to display or show equity of character or Christ's justification. So righteousness means, the Greek word means to display or show equity of character and or Christ's justification. So that's actually kind of a mouthful. Today's message is really going to be about Christ's justification. So, but part of the word righteousness means equity, you know, good character, showing character. But the root word for righteousness in the Greek also means display. So it's not just having good character, but it's sort of like a public-private kind of connection. Having a private moral life, right? Good character in terms of your personal life, but also displaying good character in public. You're saying, you know, Jesus says, you know, you can't have a light and put it under a bowl. So good character or righteousness in this sense means having a personal moral life, living a moral life, but also displaying good character. So we're not going to really talk about that part of it, that part of righteousness. We're going to talk about justification by Christ. I just want to give you an example of what it means in terms of good character. So you're going to see a diagram. On one side, you see God. In the middle, you see the church. On the other side, you see the world. So good character, in many respects, is not necessarily what you do. It's more like what's important to you. What are the things that you look toward? What are the things that you strive for? What are the things that you think about? What are the questions that you have about your life? So if the question is, well, is it okay for a Christian to dance? Is it okay for a Christian to play the lotto? Is it okay for a Christian to smoke marijuana or smoke the Juul, those vape things? You know, how far should I go with my girlfriend in our private moments together? If those are the questions that you're asking, you know, if these are the things that either you talk to your friends about or ask God about, that's one way of doing it. That's the circle where church, world, you know, you kind of go back and forth between, you know, you're in the church, you know, you can't, because you're in the church, because you're saved, you're not actually in the world, but your orientation, your mindset, your mentality, the way you think about things is, you know, you're thinking about essentially how close can I get to the line without going over. So sometimes you go over, but then you always come back. You know, you go over, then you come back. That's the person who's living in the church, but not necessarily person who's living a life of personal and public character. You know, it's, you know, you're a Christian, you know, yes, you're going to heaven, but in terms of how you conduct your life, you know, you're kind of like, you know, how close can I get to the line without going over? On the other side, if the questions are, well, how do I find out my purpose? How do I feed this family on my block? How do I go visit people in prison? How do I start up my business? How do I get promoted at my business? How do I become a better husband, better father, better wife, better mother? You know, how can I minister better to my young kids? You know, these are the kinds of things that, you know, if you're, again, nobody's perfect. Nobody can actually stay on God's side because we're not perfect. So invariably, you're going to come down. You're going to make mistakes because everybody does. But the orientation, your mindset, your mentality, the questions that you ask are the kinds of questions that put you on that side of the line. That's the person with good character, personal, moral character. But that's also displayed. Today's the scripture of the day was about Proverbs 31. The woman of noble character. This is a woman of strong moral character based on how she acted at home, how she treated her family at home, and how she conducted herself in the marketplace. She was actually out in the marketplace wheeling and dealing, buying and selling. But at the same time, she was taking care of matters at home. Her husband, right, to her face, praised his wife to his face. And also, because he did so, the children also praised the mother to her face, and he had a place of prominence out in the work, in the community. He was part of the council of elders. So if you want to have a practical example of people who have strong moral character, I know it's about the woman, and it is about her, but she had this public morality, this public righteousness, this public good character, but it was also displayed out in the marketplace. Same thing with the husband. Privately treated his family well, especially his wife. And he also had a position of prominence in the community. So that's that public pride. That's having that light shine. Don't put it under a bowl. Having it display so that your good works, people may see your good works and give glory to God. That's what happens when you try. The questions that you ask, the questions that you have are on the God side, not necessarily the world side. God will always spare you because he'll forgive you, but you're always going to be in and out of a little trouble there. But on this side, you know, you're the one that I submit to you, that you will be the one that's consistent with the woman in Proverbs 31 and her husband. So today we're going to talk about what God has done for us. We're going to talk about the justification of Christ. So let me read the scripture again. That's Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Romans chapter 14, verse 17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Three points today. Point one is the fall of man. So we talked about this a little bit in the Bible study. Adam, based on the things that happened in the Garden of Eden, human beings fell. Adam and Eve were in this pristine garden, the Garden of Eden. Everything was great. Everything was perfect. They were wealthy. They loved each other. They were always together. Things were going well. God had given them things to do. God had made Adam complete with Eve. Eve was perfect in many respects, and Adam was perfect in many respects, but because of sin that came into the garden in the guise of the snake, which was really controlled by Satan, Adam fell. And because Adam fell, all humanity fell. Well, how is that possible? You know, what does Adam have to do with me? And this is something that I always kind of struggle with. Well, you know, he did what he did. What does that have to do with me? There's a scripture that says in Jeremiah, before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you and I called you to be a prophet. So I always thought that, you know, when man and woman got together, that God somehow had this, you know, because he knew you. So I thought there was some kind of existence, right, outside of, you know, conception. Thought that maybe God had this well of souls and he would just take it and just put it into that embryo and that would be the new life. But that's not how it is. Life comes from one source, comes from one couple, comes from Adam and Eve. All of humanity came from them. So in the same way our parents, you know, two parents, if they have blue eyes, the kids are going to have blue eyes. The parents are tall, the kids are likely to be tall. If the parents are both black, the kid's going to be black. If the parents are both white, the kids are going to be white. So parents pass on genes, they pass on traits and tendencies to their children. Right, so there's nothing the kid could do about it. That's your father, he's tall. That's your mother, she's tall. You're going to be tall. When sin came into the world through Adam, it was part of their nature. So by childbirth, when they had children, when Adam and Eve conceived and had children, Cain and Abel, and later Seth, they passed on what they had to their children. So this fallen nature of man, this tendency to commit sin, this fallen nature, our inability to get it right, our inability to stay on the straight and narrow, that tendency, that trait, that sin characteristic was passed from Adam and Eve to all of us. So there's no separate, you know, life outside of Adam and Eve. That's it. Adam and Eve are the creators of all humanity. So whatever struggles and tendencies they had, we all have. The fall of man not only affected those in the garden, but it affected all of us in the same way that two parents getting together with similar traits, similar characteristics, they always pass that along to their children. You know, you're not gonna have a Chinese American couple give birth to a Russian baby with blue eyes. Two Chinese American couples, a Chinese American couple, they're not going to give birth to a Nigerian child. A Nigerian couple, they're not going to give birth to a Filipino child. In a way, it's the same way. Adam and Eve, because of sin, because of the fall of man, their traits, their characteristics are passed on to all of us. We're all, unfortunately, right, the ones who are living in the world created by Adam when he fell in the garden. That's the fall of man. Point two, Abraham believed God. Now, before we get to Jesus, we have this person, Abraham. And the thing about Abraham, it says that God kept promising him Isaac. You know, he was 75 years old when the first promised Isaac. He didn't have Isaac. He and Sarah didn't have Isaac until he was 100 years old. So he had to wait 25 years for God's promise to be manifest, not only in terms of Isaac, but also in terms of the land. He was promised that his offspring, right, his future, his seed would occupy, would be part of this land. This was their land. This was supposed to be their community. This is supposed to be their country, Israel. So it took some time for him to get from where he was to that land. But it took even longer for him to have seed promised by God as part of that promise. So, you know, he was waiting, you know, he was, you know, he got upset, he was a little bit confused. But then it says something very interesting. God brought him out. He was, you know, once again promised Isaac to him. Once again gave him a promise that from your seed, from your loins, will come an heir, will come your inheritance, will come your future. But, you know, he was old. How could somebody my age and my wife's age have a child? So God brought him outside and showed him the stars in the sky and said, if you can number the stars in the sky, that will be like your seed, like your inheritance, like your future. And it said that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteous. So even though Abraham was a son of Adam, even though Abraham had the traits and the tendencies of a sinner, the traits and tendencies of somebody who couldn't get it right. We know Abraham messed up with the whole Hagar situation. We know Abraham messed up with the king of Egypt. We know Abraham messed up with Abimelech and all the little crazy little things that happened in their family. He was not a perfect man. He made mistakes. He didn't always get it right because he was a son of Adam. But the Lord started to turn the tide and said, look, because you had faith, because you believed in me, because you believed in what I said, because you believed in the promises I gave you, I will give you righteousness. I will put righteousness in your bank, so to speak. I will credit you with righteousness. I will give you something that you didn't earn by doing. Because Abraham believed God, faith seemed to become the portal, the way, an opportunity for us to get out of the curse of Adam and the fall of man and to become right with God. Not by doing this or by doing that or by being perfect. Remember that? You'll never be perfect. You're always going to mess up. You're always going to strive for God. Most times you're going to get there. Sometimes you won't. Sometimes you're going to get it right. Sometimes you won't. But if you believe God, if you have faith in God, he will credit you with righteousness. That's the start of the turn. When God credited Abraham with righteousness, not because of what he did, but because of what he believed. And point three, made righteous by Christ. So here comes Jesus. He was sin for us. He, without sin, died on a cross, a sinner's death. He died for us. So his death and his resurrection and his being beaten and his being humiliated was a substitute for all the humiliation that we have to live because of Adam, because of this sin nature, because of this thing that was passed from Adam onto us. And we try to get it right and we mess up. We do it right, then we mess up again. We do it really good for a couple of years, then we mess up again. We're always falling off the wagon, always falling short, but now Christ came. And because Christ came, he made us righteous, but only to those that believe. If you have faith in Jesus Christ, this message is for those who are not saved. This message is for those who are not in the body of Christ. If you believe God, if you accept Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, he will credit you with righteousness. You will be made righteous. In other words, you know, with Abraham, it's sort of like putting some money into his account. But with Christ, your whole being becomes righteous. When the Lord sees you, He doesn't see your sin. He sees your relationship, your connection to Jesus Christ. If you confess Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, you will become made righteous. Now, an example of this is in Zechariah chapter 3. This is just like a type of being made righteous. But Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. You can turn there if you like. And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I will cause thine iniquity to pass from thee, and will clothe thee with change of raiment. And I said, let them set a fair mitre upon his head. So they set a fair mitre, which is a turban, upon his head, and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by. Then the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, if thou wilt walk with my ways and will keep my charge, then thou shalt also judge my house, and thou shalt keep my courts, and I will give thee place to walk among thee that stand by. Here he is, the high priest is the most holy person in the priesthood. He's the one that gets an opportunity to go once a year to the Holy of Holies and offer sacrifice to the people. But there's a problem. He's a son of Adam. Right? Here he is, the high priest, right? The one who God selects to minister before him. The only person allowed to minister before him for the people. Huge opportunity, a huge burden, gigantic responsibility. But he's a son of Adam, so he's wearing filthy clothes. He can't get it right. He's a son of Adam. He can't be righteous on his own. He's a sinner. And the sin is represented by his filthy clothes. And guess who's standing there right next to him? Satan. Satan, yeah, he's a deceiver, but he's also called the accuser of the brethren. He stood right there to talk about him. Oh, your wife left you? Oh, your son is in jail? Oh, you owe a bunch of taxes? Oh, was that you on page 6 of the Daily News? Oh, you were arrested when you were a kid for DWI. Oh, you were a molested when you were a little kid. He stands there accusing him, even as he's ministering before the Lord. Angels all around. With the burden of the people, the responsibility of the people on his heart. And he's trying to minister, but Satan is accusing him, reminding him of his dirty clothes, his soiled clothes. And the Lord says, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Take off those filthy clothes of that man and give him clean clothes. But man, woman, that's what it's like when you get saved. You're trying your best to do the right thing. I see you helping out at the homeless shelter, taking care of your grandmother, being a good husband to the best of your ability, being an excellent wife to the best of your ability, getting promotion after promotion, doing well. But your works, because of the curse of Adam, still leave you, even as you're working in society with filthy clothes. And you sit there and you try to pray, and sometimes you can't even pray because all you keep thinking about is all of your shortcomings, all the areas where I fell short, all the bad things that happened to me, all of the missed opportunities in my life because Satan is accusing you. Even as you're trying to do the right thing, even as you're trying to walk the walk, he's accusing you and reminding you of your failures. Of all the things that didn't go right. But if you accept Jesus Christ as Lord, your faith will turn the whole game around. Jesus has come to die for you. He's your sin replacement. He will take off your filthy clothes and put on clean clothes. Put on a garment of white. Because when the Lord sees you, he no longer sees your filthy clothes, no longer sees your unrighteous acts. He only sees you through Christ. And Christ has made you righteous. He has taken off your filthy clothes and put on clean garments. That's what it's like to be saved. That's good news. That's what he's done for me. So brother, so sister, so man, so woman, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and your Savior, I've got good news for you. You have an opportunity to do that today. You could turn your life around. You could change your life today. And if you do, he will make you righteous. No matter how hard you try, you can never get it right because we're all sons and daughters of Adam. But here comes the second Adam, the one who didn't fail, the one who passed the test. He was in the desert. Adam was in the garden. He passed the test. He spoke up. He spoke the word of God. And because of that, and he died, and he was resurrected. Because of that, he gives us an opportunity. He gives us a chance to get it right, but not through our own means, but by faith in him. If you need Jesus today, pray this prayer with me. Lord, I'm a sinner. I've tried it my way. Now I give my life to you. I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of my life, and I believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead. Therefore, I am saved. If that's you, just send us an email, give us a call, let us know your story. My name is Marlon Curtin. This is the Rockaway Cathedral. We're building God's kingdom in you. Go in victory. Go in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, we thank you for your word today. It teaches us that you do not look at the physical, but rather you look at the way we live our lives. Lord, you see our hearts. Holy Spirit, help us to live a life of goodness, peace, and joy. Please sustain and feed us spiritually and emotionally. We want others to look at us and desire to serve you, our Heavenly Father. However, we can only do this with the strength and guidance of the Holy Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, we ask that you reign in and over our lives so that we can become more and more like Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. You have truly blessed us with your presence. We look forward to seeing you again next Sunday, and we hope that you will study the Word of God with us on Wednesdays from 7 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Visit our website for further details, and while you're there, click on the subscribe button and subscribe to our ministry. It helps and encourages us to see that we are reaching you. Until then, stay safe, and may God continue to bless you. And remember, you are dismissed from this service, but never dismissed from God's presence. Thank you.